Hello again. So last week we talked quite a bit about sexual selection. And this week we are more focused on parental investment. So this video hopefully will make the connection for you between sexual selection and parental investment.
Have you ever noticed that traditionally many men have had the reputation for having a roving eye? Like Casanova, Hugh Hefner, President Bill Clinton, Elvis, and many among the mammal males have had that reputation of being a wolf. Let's look at some of the scientific explanations for why that is. It all begins with an initial inequality. This wonderful big egg that is the mother's contribution that takes a lot of energy and is very expensive to manufacture, as opposed to dad's initial contribution, which are many small, very inexpensive sperm. Let's start by looking at mammals, because we are mammals, and mammals invest very differently in their offspring according to whether they are male or female. Almost always, the female has a much greater investment in the offspring than the male. Well, why mom? Well, maternity certainty is almost 100%. We moms know that our babies are ours because we grow them in our own bodies. An egg is bigger than a sperm. It takes more energy to produce an egg. Months of gestation, 9 months for humans. Months of nursing. Well, why not the father? Why doesn't he invest as much? Well, dad doesn't carry the little guy in his body, so actual paternity certainty is technically very low. Human fathers may recognize their genes in their newborns, but usually it is impossible to know at first glance. So this idea is that these factors shape sexual selection in divergent ways. And this is called Bateman's principle, which predicts that reproductive strategies diverge by sex. It makes sense. Mother invests more into the offspring than the father, so reproductive strategies are very different. So it's plain to see that females invest very heavily in their offspring, and by so doing, they enhance their own reproductive success more than if they were to put all their energy into mating. No matter how many mating opportunities a female mammal takes, she can still only produce offspring every so many months, 9 months for humans, and then spend considerable time nursing them, which is also very expensive energy-wise. Male mammals, on the other hand, don't carry the baby, they don't nurse them, and so they can greatly enhance their reproductive success by mating often. So we see many male mammals mating frequently and promiscuously. So in general, most female mammals will invest more in parenting, and males will invest more in mating. As we all know, all of our activities take energy, so we need to make what we call investment trade-offs. Acquiring food and getting away from predators is a form of somatic investment. Reproductive investment is divided into parental effort and mating effort. And males and females will deploy their resources differently. This sometimes results in a struggle for how much to invest in each of these, and this brings us back to Darwin's sexual selection. Sex bias strategies of sexual selection, like male-male competition or intersexual selection, and the females choosing which males to mate with, which is called intrasexual selection. Another way to look at this is through inequalities in sex ratio. Geneticist Ronald Fisher predicted that there was a balance in sex ratio, about half male and half female, and this was based on the assumption of monogamy. According to Fisher, these breeding populations should be about 50% male and 50% female, but when there's an imbalance and there are more males than females, then parents will see that their daughters have higher mating success. And so those parents will invest in their daughters until the numbers balance out. and vice versa. If there are more females, then the same goes for the sons. This later was added to by the Trivor-Willard hypothesis. In most human societies, females can marry up the social ladder, which we call hypergamy, and males can marry down the social ladder, which we call hypogamy. Trivors-Willard predicted that people at the bottom of the social ladder will invest in daughters, and the upper classes will invest in sons. And in many human societies, this is precisely what we see. Anna Nicole married right up that social ladder and made lots of money from it. And then there was Prince Charles, who, when you're at the top, the only place you can marry is down. And so he married Lady Diana. Wasn't that far of a fall? It's important to remember that universals don't mean that we see this prediction in every case, but in humans, these reflect trends that are common and cross-cultural. So let's review. Bateman's principle predicts that males will invest their reproductive energy into mating, and females will invest more heavily in parenting effort. Somatic investment involves acquiring food and avoiding predators. Females marrying up the social ladder is known as hypergamy, and males marrying down the social ladder is known as hypogamy. So it is predicted that in situations where the parents are at the bottom of the social ladder, they will invest more heavily in their daughters, and where the parents are at the top of the social ladder, they will invest more heavily in sons.